bright and early Monday morning out on the pond. Cherche le carp grand, which may or may not mean looking for big carp. Probably not. We're on the water, by the way. Very, very, very calm. But very nice looking water. Waiting for one to clatter out. While I was loading the boat from the car park, I see a couple of big splashes right up this end. It's quite a long way to see what was what, but or where they were exactly, but I did see a couple of eruptions somewhere up here. It's not too busy, which is nice. It's always very tempting just grab a swim that you fancy, but that's often the worst move. Find the fish first, that's the one. I'm not sure what's happened at the weekend, but in general, I don't think this particular bit here has been fish much lately. Most of the fish have been up the other end, car park end. And carp just love a quiet bit, don't they? Until some clown stands out in the middle of it in a boat videoing, which would be me. Well, us. She's looking too. Come on, carp. Give the game away.
Well, it's now 11 o'clock. And I'm in my about third different area and I haven't even got the rods out yet. I very nearly set up next door. It's done quite a few bites apparently, which is I don't like going after because you think, oh, it might be all over, but it did look good. And I sat there and I watched and I watched and I watched, and I see it, two coots with a load of babies go out there and dive down, and they were just feeding the babies boilies one after the other. I thought, well, that ain't very good. There's a load of uneaten bait down there, so I scrapped that idea. Then the wind changed, so I looked at the other end, and now I'm back in Butcher's Point, which has been fairly kind to me over the last month or so. It's where I had that lever from. I've got a couple of spots in here I like. It's all close in stuff. But the rods are still in the boat. And they're at sea. And I still ain't really very sure what I want to do. I've seen precious little. One of them days. One of them dunno what to do days. Well, another one of them don't know what to do days. Most days are a bit like that, to be honest. I've got a new little feature out there. Where is that? Zoom in, or is that out? Get off. Help, my phone's doing something bizarre now. Don't know whether that's any better or not. Yeah, we've got a new feature out there, which is some barley straw and a buoy. So yeah, I don't know. The more this wind blows, the more I think I should go and have a look up the other end, although I know it's only blowing for today, but it might be enough to move a few. I don't know, help me. So, whilst boating about, between
every swim on the lake. I see one clatter out over there near an old, there's an old barge in the middle of that sort of bay, in that little bit of slack water. And the fish can actually get right under it. It's all snaggy around it. I see one over there, so we're going to try in here to start with. I can't talk for long because we've just got them non-stop at the moment. They are literally relentless. There's about 10 seconds between one drifting out of sound and the next one coming in, which makes it all a bit tricky. But there you go. Right, I'm going to get stuff sorted. And that's one rod, and figure out what to do with the other two. Somewhere out here. How is it 3 o'clock in the afternoon? How did that happen? I got up at 4 o'clock this morning, 11 hours ago, and I've got one rod in the water. One. Well, it looks like it's ready to go, but it isn't. It's got the wrong rig on it. The other one's still in the rod bag. Why does everything take so long? I haven't even had breakfast yet. Well, that's a lie, actually. I have. If you can count Mediterranean-inspired platter as breakfast. Basically, I've had olives. Oh well, hang another hour or two and I'll be ready. Then it'll be dinner time. I don't know where the time goes, I really don't. It's scorching as well. Luckily I've got some shade in here now, as you can see. I've left my shorts in the van. Oh well, onwards and upwards. There was only going to be one winner. He has been following me around forever, this little bugger. Little green-eyed monster. Finally, he decided to bite me. So he die. Sorry, pal, but it was me or you. Right, we're all set up, look. Everything ready to rock and roll, barbecue's on. Life is good. Improvised in the shorts department. I've got some legs on me, and I, hey, look at them. Like rugby players' legs. Oh no, them other things in rugby. Goalposts. Corner flags, that's what they are. Oh, got my barbecue a bit hot, it's all gone twisted. Don't want to work now. God, it's right out of kilter. Now it's going to collapse. Comes with a little pin across the bottom that holds it all straight. I lost it about 1,000 times and re-found it, and now I've actually lost it. In fact, I've lost everything. Grill mat. Look at that brand spanker, that one. Not even cut to size yet. Is it going to rip straight? No.
Perfect. Almost. Close enough. I'm so hungry. Thinking about these shorts, to be honest. Right, come on carp. Stop buggering about and just pull my strings. Time for buggering about is gone. I want a bite, and I want it now. Well, that is the middle of the afternoon, but snag fishing on one rod, that's still viable. I need some gloves, don't I, for barbecuing. It's not the same as the cob. The cob doesn't get hot on the outside, the barbecue gets bloody boiling. This could end badly. Could be the end of me nice Navitas hoodie. Eight sizes too big, but I love it. I wear it at home, like a doss around the house thing. Ow. I don't know what's happened to my barbecue. It's as twisted as a twisted thing that's all twisted. It's all going wrong, folks. Life falling apart. Oh. You've heard of the Terminator, obviously. Well, this, here she comes, on cue, is the Verminator. She's been up there stalking mice, haven't you, all day. Come on in. Here, 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 up, up, here, up. Ooh. Hello, Verminator. Have you caught any yet? She's just staring at one spot for an hour, and then suddenly, big pounce. I can't see any mice for the barbie. Catch me a mice, I'll cook it for you. Go catch Mickey and we'll chuck him on the barbie. Oh yes. What's that? What's that? Motorbike. Whoa. Well, I've got an odd set up here. I mean, it even looks odd. I've got three rods doing three completely different jobs. Shut up, I'm trying to talk. I got that one where I saw a fish this morning. There's somebody in here, I don't know whether you saw that, but there was someone in here last night. I was chatting to him and I saw a fish out there and a load of bubbling up, well, sheeting up it was. So there were a few fish out there. He didn't catch any of them, but that makes me think there's more chance of them still being around tomorrow. Then I got the middle rod, which is on a little spot that I've baited previously, where I've seen no fish. To be honest, if I was only fishing that spot, I wouldn't fish it from here, probably. That's like a trial rod. That would be the first one that gets moved if they start showing anywhere. So that's my least favourite. This one's probably my most favourite from what I saw this morning. And then I've got my snag rod, where I have seen a fish jump about a rod length back off of where I'm fishing. And the guy in here before said he see quite a few actually in and around the snags and in and around the barge. So fish have been seen there, I've seen one. The fish have definitely been there, I've seen one. And that one I ain't got a clue about. They're barely all in the same swim, to be honest. They're all over the place. Well, that's good. I'm asking three questions instead of one.
Look at that lot. Do they look good or do they look good? That's going to be wondrous, that is. A bit of cheesy coleslaw. Yum, diddly yum. These are lovely, these little ribby things. Well, they're not ribs, they're belly slices.
Only thing missing really is a bit of melted cheese on that burger. We can live without that. I'm beginning to wonder whether this is such a good idea. Not the cider, that's a good idea. The no bivvy approach. Because that up there is looking quite moody. As I'm sure you all agree. The weather app says no rain. I'm not sure I entirely believe it.
Mosquito that could have got in here but didn't. God, as you might tell, I've only just woken up, can't even talk yet, so I'm not going to. Well, the mosquito didn't get me last night. There's hundreds of them on the outside, but none on the inside. Ooh. It's proper early. 2 early to be talking. Ooh. No bites or nothing as yet. I've seen one fish right out there in the middle. Nowhere near anything that I'm fishing. Oh, I need tea and toothpaste. Did you see that one? Yeah. They are about. They're quite a bit closer in than I am.
it's a bit windy out now. Well, we've actually moved. But it's got to be the smallest move I've ever done in my life. That's where I was, on that big platform. Hang on. So I was on that big jetty there, and I'm now on that little jetty right next to it, where the white chair is. Oh look, there's Madalena, fast asleep in the mud under a tree. Yeah, we've moved about 8 foot. But the territory we're fishing comes with that. They are actually two swims. I've never seen two people fishing them at once, but we thought we'd do the right thing and get in the right swim. It's a better angle anyway, to be honest. Maddie likes it, look. She's a proper outdoor little thing, isn't she? Well, big thing. So that's what we've done. We've moved from there to there. And that's it. That's the move for the day. Just been out and put a cane where I'd seen fish. Had a little prod around with me prodder. Too busy filming. If you heard that, that was me running aground that far short of the jetty.
Right, we have two rods. We have two opposing styles. The right hand rod, he's on a cane, boated out, prodded and done whatever. The left hand one is cast, bottom bait, marker, catapult. So old school v new school. Wonder what will win.
So, while we're waiting for a bite, I've just been out and had a look around the snags over there. And it reminded me of a little story. It was, I don't know, a few years ago, 2 or 3 years ago, I was fishing a lake that was particularly snaggy. And I was in this swim and I had a big snag about 80 yards in front of me and fishing right up against it, one rod. As soon as you hook the fish, they try and get in the snag, obviously, like they would, as hard as they could, proper go for it, and you just had to hang on, give them no line, 35 pound braid right through, hang on to them, and then there'd be a big kick and they'd roll over and they'd come out. But they knew, as carp do, the next best place to go. So to the left of the snag, as I look at it, excuse me, was a channel, and right round to my left was an island. I'm on an island, but there's another island round to the left. And off of this island was a big row of snags where all the trees had fallen in over the years, all hanging down there. And they knew that if they gave up on that snag, they went as fast as they could across the channel, which was about 50 yards, I suppose. And then they could make these snags on the other bank. So what you had to do was recover as much line as you could to get them inside this island. And once they came inside the island, they were yours. But that was the crack. Hold them out of the first snag, and then, like I say, retrieve as much line as you could, get them inside the second snag, all over. Problem was, over the years, various trees had fallen down off of this island into the water and went right out, and there was one tree. It was on the closest side of the island, and it had gone down in. It was probably, oh, I don't know, 30 foot long, something like that. And it was split into two bows. Now the bottom bow had gone down and dug into the silt on the bottom of the lake, and the top bow was directly sort of level, sort of parallel with the surface of the water, and it was about 2 foot under. And I decided, in my infinite wisdom, I was going to remove this snag. Because if I got rid of this one end snag, then if the fish kited around it, it would be an absolute piece of piss to land them. So I devised a little plan. Oh, I knew that was going to be hot. All I had was one of those little flick saws. They're like fold out saws. Sandvik make them, various other companies make them. It's a proper wood saw. It's got those two opposing teeth all the way down the blade, sharp as. And this little plastic handle. Problem was, the bow I wanted to cut was the main bow above the split, and it was about 2.5 foot under the water. Couldn't reach it with this little saw. So I got the saw and I searched through the bushes, and I found this great big long bleached white dead branch, probably, I don't know, 4 foot, 5 foot long, like a pole, almost like a round fence post, if you like. So I've got the saw, rummaged through the gear, and I found a big roll of that, what's the make, gorilla tape, but that real tree, camo tape. So I've taped the handle to this big long pole, taped it all up, taped it all up, got it proper safe. And I've looked at it and I thought, it looks really good. It'd look a lot better if the whole of this pole was done. So I've used up about, I don't know what, it's about 12 and a half quid a roll, isn't it? I've used up the whole roll and I've ended up with this beautiful, it's like a samurai saw thing. Big camouflage pole, this big saw on the end. Got it all going, I thought, that to the business. So, got out there in the boat, put my life jacket on, rowed out there. Now I've had to think about it, because I thought, what's going to happen here when I actually cut through the tree? I don't want the tree to sink, because if the tree sinks, obviously it makes it even worse, because it's on the bottom. So I've pulled in the boat right to the base of the tree, and I've tied the back of the boat, I've gone in face forwards, so I've tied the back of the boat to the tree that's going to be cut off. And I've given it a fair bit of rope, because I thought, what's going to happen? I'm going to cut through, and then that tree is going to sink. Might sink, might float, might sink. But if it sinks, the boat, it will still be attached to the boat. I don't want it to pull the boat under either, so I've attached the front of the boat to the other end of the snag, which is still attached to the island. It hasn't snapped, it's just fallen over, so the root ball is still in the island. So you've got this tree like this, you've got me attached to this end by the front, and me attached to this end by the back. So two ropes. Perfect. What can go wrong? Got my waders on. I'm in the boat. I've got 1 foot in the boat, and I've got the other foot in the lake on the base of the tree, just where it comes off the island. And I've got my saw on my pole underwater. And I'm sawing away. And surprisingly easy to saw underwater. It's like lubrication on the blade, if you like. So I'm like that, and I'm going like this, going like this. The old elbow's going like the old fiddler's elbow. And all of this sawdust and that's coming out underwater. It's like milk, you know, and it's all coming off, coming off. I'm sawing through. I got about halfway through. The weirdest thing happened. I got about halfway through, making obviously quite a lot of noise. And I've looked down, and this common's come round. He's about, I don't know, mid-20, I suppose. And he's come round, and he's come right underneath where I'm sawing, underneath this bow, and gone off round. And then he's come back with a mate. In the end, there was three of them, these mid-20-pound commons, maybe upper 20s even, circling this area that I'm sawing. They're just interested. Carp are really curious creatures, you know. And they're circling around right underneath where I'm sawing. At first I was like frozen. I thought, oh, you know, they're here. And then I realised that they'd come in to see what all the noise was about. So anyway, I'm sawing and sawing away. In the end, I've ignored the carp. They were just there watching as well. And I'm sawing and sawing. It's probably taken, it's taken a while. I don't know, let's say 3/4 of an hour maybe to get through this limb. But then I'm getting to the stage where the saws, it's dug in a few times, I've managed to free it and that, but it's getting to a stage where I thought, it's nearly through, it's within, you know, a gnat's cock of going through. Any second, something's gonna happen. So I've sort of looked at it and planned, and I thought, well, I'm stood on the main limb with one leg. I've got one leg in the boat like this, and I've got one leg underwater in the waders up to the top of my thigh, and the back of the boat up to the back of my knee. So I'm sort of hooked into the boat. I'm quite stable. I'm soaring down. I thought, as soon as I go through, the bit out in the water that I want to remove, you know, my plan is once it's sawed off, I'm going to tie it to the back of the boat and drag it away. That's going to go down. You know, that's going to drop and then hit the rope. The boat's going to give it a bit of a jolt. I didn't really think about the bit attached to the bank. You know, I assumed that that was quite solid and was going to stay where it was. So that was my main sort of support on my left leg. So I'm soaring and I'm soaring, and suddenly, whoonk, it's gone through and it's cleared. And totally the opposite happened of what I thought was going to happen. The piece that's now, that, oh, 20 foot plus whatever, that's unattached suddenly, instead of sinking, that's come up in the water, like very, very quickly. And the piece that my left leg's on has gone down, because it was only the bottom spur of the tree that was bracing it all. So as I've cut through, the bit attached to the island is now not attached to anything. So that's gone down at a rate of knots, and the boat's gone up in the water, and my leg's still in the boat. So as the boat's gone up, like, whoa, like that, and this leg's gone down, I've gone over. I've gone out the boat, into the lake, into the snags. Now, I was wearing at the time one of these gas-powered life jackets, like this, all clipped up. Now, if you've got no experience of a life jacket going off, you know, you won't understand this at all. But if you have ever had one of these go off, you'll know what I'm talking about. They've got a water sensor in there. As soon as it gets wet, it just goes, pff, gas canister in here, explodes and puffs them up. They've got poppers all down the back, and a big yellow jacket just flies out like that, goes, pff, and it's up. They are so tight, they're designed that if you're unconscious, it holds your head up in the water. But in reality, what it does is it tightens around your throat. It cuts off your, what's it called, your carotid artery. My head felt like it had suddenly no blood. It was like I was in a chokehold. I'm in the water, yeah, this leg's still in the boat. And my whole body's underwater, apart from the life jacket, which is round my neck like that, I can't breathe. My head's out the water, and that bit of my chest about here is out the water. The rest of my body's up in the air in the boat, which is much higher than me. I'm folded over. I can't escape. I'm bent over, so I can't get back in the boat because I'm bent in this bizarre shape. I can't get the life jacket off. I'm thinking, I'm in trouble here, you know. I've got one leg, one wader now full of water weighing me down. I've got one leg up in the boat pulling me up in the air. I've got a life jacket floating in my head, and I've got my bum underwater. And I'm still holding onto my saw. I would not let go of my saw. I thought, there is no way on this planet I'm letting go of my saw. I love this saw, I've only just made it. So I did what any sensible person would do. Well, that's sensible. I did what I thought was best. I've got this big yellow puffy jacket round here. I sawed straight through it. I just pulled up the saw and went, whew. It instantly exploded and filled my face. I've got a face full of compressed gas, which was disgusting. Absolutely, you know, all that plastic and dust and gas. I just got this big of gas. But the jacket went down, and suddenly I could like lower myself down and get this leg out of the boat. Hello, Madeleine. And save myself, as it were. And I clambered back out and managed to get in the boat. By this time, I was completely soaked from head to foot.
and eventually managed to get the snag out and boat it off to safety. But I mean, you know, life jackets, how ironic would that have been? You know, death by life jacket. And that's almost what it was. The life jacket almost bloody killed me. So yeah, that's just a little story that I remembered when I was looking in the snags out there. Dodgy thing, snags. But at least I saved me sore, eh?
Whilst on lockdown of changing your splicing life.
Look at this, we're doing a little bit of double blogging tonight.
I won't advertise them too much at the minute though.
Moz is doing a folks live.
They're probably out.
And I'm just cooking, as always.
So, how do, Jude? How do everyone? I should answer.
Nosing in from the background.
I've been rabbiting on for a little while.
You've been rabbiting on for bloody ages, I'll tell you.
Matthew.
Waffling on. Right, Moz is. Live cast thing had to end very prematurely when his battery ran out.
How professional.
So if you were watching the Fox Live and it suddenly cut off, that's why he ran out of battery. A bit like my dog, who's definitely run out of battery. Look at the state of her. But the cooking, however, the cooking is going a treat. We've got like a little oven thing going on the barbie. We've got mushrooms, garlic mushrooms, we've got corn on the cobs, and we have chilli chicken, obviously. Sweet chilli chicken, I believe. So life is good. Is life good, Moz?
Life is beautiful when you're cooking, Dave.
Yeah, I know, I'm always cooking. Although you did cook for me on Butcher's Point the other week.
Well, I went to the fish and chip shop.
Oh, well, that's sort of cooking, isn't it? Well done. Right, I need to get on my cooking duties. See you later, ta-da.
What's my plate?
Oh, ah, oh, his plate's gone. Oh no.
Nothing like weighing your plate down, is it?
Look at all this mad lane, all right? Look, Matt. They're going to lick in their chops. How lovely.
We're videoing?
We're videoing.
Right, here we go, it's all coming out. It's one of them, isn't it? Why do they do everything in fours? Do they not think of three people to eat together?
We've got smoke effect going on here. And tonight, Matthew, I'm gonna. Oh, look at this beast.
Everything's in a four.
Oh, look at that.
Various divvy up. We've got some stuff going on here, haven't we?
We have indeed.
I'll tell you what, I can cook. Well, actually, we'll wait for the verdict of that. Right, so we've got two of them. That'll work out. Who prefers chicken or burgers? Because you're going to get two or one.
We're not fussy, Dave.
I ain't fuss, Dave. Have whatever you prefer, mate. You cooked it.
Oh, now you put me in a position. I'm going to have burgers. Bloody hell, we've got some grub, mate.
Haven't we just?
Look at that lot.
Oh no.
I've got some olives as well.
Olives? You couldn't squeeze an olive on that plate. We've got three forks and a knife. How does that work? There's another knife.
Oh, look at this lot.
Right. So there's a knife and fork. There's a knife and fork. Right, come and get your bucket then.
Oh, yes, Dave, that is beautiful. Well done, that
right.
Man.
Thank you,
Dave.
Ta-da.
Morning, all. Well, I know it's a little bit early for school, but it's time for a maths lesson. You know the one. 3 - 1 = carp. It's about, oh, I don't know, 5:30. 5:45 now, but I literally got up, had half of that cup of tea, stood next to the rods, and that one rattled off. So we still haven't answered the competition yet, whether it's new school or old school on them two. But the other one has produced me a fish. So I've got to get busy and get that bait back out there a bit pronto. While I'm busy getting my bait on and getting ready to boat it back out there, I'll leave you with this. And probably even a little tune. Don't go anywhere. Thanks a lot, I hope you enjoyed it. I'm now going out in that out there somewhere. Right, that's the bait back out there. Just been and woke up the lads next door. Well, one was awake, one wasn't. I'm gonna do the photos in a sec. And then hopefully, it's about the right time of the morning for something to start happening out in this channel. Because it has the last two mornings, but I'll be completely honest with you, it's a little bit quiet out there at the moment. One actually did jump close in round to the left, almost in this little bay. But there's no visible sort of sheeting up or anything yet. So our little competition between old school and new school, so far, isn't running. Or something just... I don't know, it might have been that gull. I'm not sure, something might have just hit the surface over the back there. Right, here we go. I've got a carp at last. We've hijacked film crew from next door. So, he's half decent one, he is. I like him. All right, calm down, calm down, calm down. We only want to take your picture. Hmm? Yeah, I do, yeah. Okay, okay, we only want a photograph. Over 30.
Is he?
31 and a little bit. Something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, mate.
31 something?
Yeah, yeah. 31.
Just hiding right about bits. 31 and change. That's what we like. Dirty 30 for breakfast.
There we go. We got her up.
Lovely.
Yeah, we've got a backing track. Bit of Kill Bill. Back she goes. Ta-da, baby. Although I think you're a boy, actually. Nice. Time for breakfast.
So, we've had a 30 pounder. Seen two more fish since then. Been an awful lot. There's nothing in the channel, so the battle of the channel rods is null and void, but we have this breakfast of champions. Look at that. Perfect. Madeline is having a crafty kick. Little chin rest there. Hoping that the rods will do something, but I think it's gone that time. But we've had one. That's the main thing. Happy boy.
Look at them getting all arty with it.
My arse ain't out, is it, Dave?
Yeah, your arse is always out. I know the exact brand of your pants. Come on, Moz, keep it together. You're supposed to be looking awful sexy and stuff. Right, just been to the shops. Returned with some cider and ice. Half a chicken, so that's all sorted. I am staying tonight. I've now got to battle the wind to get my baits out there. It might not look like a lot through the camera, but it is proper gusty. I just came up the channel to the left, where I did the non-starter rod challenge. I could hardly get back up it. The boat was just flat out and the boat was going nowhere. So this could be, well, interesting, I think. Probably the correct terminology. And we shall see. Clonking great leads on to hold the bottom out there. I've got two spots, I ain't got a clue what I'm going to do with the third rod. I'm just hoping that they're going to turn up again out there tomorrow morning. I want a bigger one. Oh, bloke up the other end's just had a big one, big 30. On the wind, and there's four of us on and four of us have caught today. It's been my 30, matey's large 30, and a couple of sort of scraper 20 size. Moz has had one, and matey over the right up the opposite end. So it basically practically all four corners of the lake have done a fish, or four sections of the lake. Everything's good. Right, I'm gonna crack on. Right, it's that time of night. It is grub time. I've once again retired to Mozzie's swim because it's out the wind a little bit. It's right next to mine. And we're having barbecue and cob tonight. They're having steaks. I've got half a Mexican chicken. I am absolutely Hank Marvin. Bring it on.
All right, they're ready for steaks. I know I'm going to burn this out. Come on, fall out.
Didn't want that bit of skin anyway.
No, I do. I love the skin. I've only lost a little bit.
Hey, Moz.
You like my friend with the old...
I like it. It's how it's
socks tucked here. I got battered by mosquitoes. I've got about a million bites down.
It's the old push bike special, isn't it?
Yeah.
Got the treader outside.
Yeah.
Okay. Looking good down there, Moz.
Looking beautiful, isn't it?
Yeah.
Got the corn and the cobs wrapped in butter.
Hey.
You give me that idea.
I know. I'm full of good ideas. I'm also full of rubbish ideas. It's just picking the... sorting out, what they call it? The wheat from the chaff?
Something like that.
How's my... talking doing in there?
He's looking good. Right, you lot, we're going to eat dinner. And you lot are going to just disappear, and I've got about that much battery left. That much. Ta-da.
Morning all. Welcome to a scene of total devastation. That's where I was. And I had to sling that up just now. It's too lazy to stay in it. Bed's soaked. I've had no sleep at all. I woke up in the sort of mizog rain. I've been kept awake all night by mosquitoes and bats. Mosquitoes have been feeding on me, and the bats have been swooping within about a half an inch of my face to feed on the mosquitoes. It's been a weird old night. It's been very, very hot, ridiculous. Probably 18 degrees in the night. Too hot to get in the bag, too mozzied to get out. I should have just got up and put the mosquito net up. That's what I should have done. But it all started about sort of 2 o'clock, and you think, oh, you're nearly through the night, it's hardly worth it. So I'm absolutely shattered. I had no bites, so I'm not going to give it too long, and then I'm going to pack up, go home, carry on. I've been rebuilding my studio for filming my new YouTube channel, the Inner Circle thing. What are we on now? I've done second episode goes out this Friday. You probably all know about it, but if you don't, I'm going through. Like I did in lockdown when I did the obsession with carp. Did all the stories right through the whole book. Well, I'm doing that with Flick of the Tail and Beyond, Fine Lines, the whole lot. On a sort of monthly Patreon, it's called. It's a pay as you go sort of channel. It's £5 a month. Putting something out every week, like an episode a week, and blogs and competitions and all sorts of stuff. I've still got quite a lot of work at home to do. I was planning on doing loads of it today, but I think I'm going to go home and go to bed. And start tomorrow. Don't know, we shall see. Right, I'm going to make a cup of tea, roll a fag. I'm going to show you my little trailer for my new channel. And then I'm going to rejoin you straight after. We will be back after this commercial break.
So as you go down the path, the trees all meet over the top and make this tunnel, this magical, mysterious cove, if you like. And as you emerge at the far end of it, that's when you get your first glimpse of the mere. I have no idea what made me stop and turn round halfway back to the car. The wind's still whipping across the surface of the lake, and I stopped. I just looked over my shoulder, and there he was, the biggest carp in the UK, out of the water, up to his tail root, defying gravity for half a second, and then bosh, back into the lake. Spray went everywhere, There was just no way I was going home after seeing that. As soon as I went over there, I mean, a year we hadn't even walked the far bank, couldn't get to it, and I found the route through, and I'd got there, and I walked into this bay, and it was gin clear and deep and overhung and beautiful. The first bush I looked down, right in front of me, I poked my head through the bush, saw a bit of a movement, and he was there, the eye, you know, the biggest carp I'd ever seen in my life, right below me, right there, looking straight at me. 17 years I had that dog. She knew me better than anybody else. I'd not known anybody else in my life for that period of time. She was one hell of a hound. And I'm that close, I'm stood in the reeds, I've got them parted like a little curtain, the rod's propped against my hip, the tips on the floor, on the sand in the shallows right in front of me. I can see the single tiger nut, and then Black Jack comes around the corner, it's him. And he goes over the tiger nut, I think he's going past it, the bait winks out of existence underneath him, and at the last second his fins bristle, and there's a kick and a woof of silt, and the rod's ripped up out the ground and he's on. So after, 7 years on and off of heaven and hell, basically, standing there, 3 o'clock in the morning, in the waters of the mere, I looked in the net and I could see that tail with the crop out of the top, and I knew it was him. So that's what that's all about, if you're interested. And something's happened while I've been away. When I finished filming that last little bit, I looked at my phone and I'd got a text from the guy up the other end of this island. Now, I can't remember how we started 3 days ago, this video, this blog. But I don't remember if I filmed the first bit or not, where I went into a swim called the All Alone, unpack the boat, and then watch the coots eating a load of old boilies, so repack the boat and moved up here. Well, that swim I rejected, you know where this is going, that swim I rejected yesterday, did, I can't remember, it was up a 30 or almost 40 pounder, and that same man has just texted me, said, can I go and do some photos for him, because he's just caught the biggin. So I reckon I got that wrong, didn't you? Fish called Royds, biggest fish in the pond, the one we're all waiting for, all amazed that it hasn't been out yet. Well, it just has. Not sure how big yet, but it's going to be around 60 pounds. It's going to be the biggest carp I've ever seen on the bank in the UK. By some margin. So, well done that man. Let's wander up the path and see what he's got, shall we? Let's go. Right, here we are in the swim that I wrote off on Monday as being not worth a go. Was it worth a go?
Just a bit.
See, I know my stuff. There's nothing coming out of here, it's been battered. Well, this man's battered it, well done.
Thank
you. And he's got an absolute monster. A monster. Right. Let's drag it out and have a look. What's going to be the biggest fish I've ever seen on the bank in the UK? Let's do it.
Don't forget, Mods, we've got to try and not look jealous. An awful lot of carp in there.
Right,
And no swearing on my blog when you unzip it. Well, I say my blog, I think my blog's been taken over. Right, let's go and have a proper look.
Look at that.
Oh my God, it's a monster.
Yeah, she's empty though, isn't she?
Yeah.
She's empty there, isn't she?
Happy?
Well done, man.
All right, nice one.
Excellent. Right, let's do the do.
It's
bloody massive, isn't it?
Lovely. Size of the head.
Got to get that shot. Oh.
Yeah, mate.
Nice.
Couldn't have picked a better time to have her.
I know. No cameras on the firm.
And when you're ready, mate, you can let her go.
Away she goes.
Don't let her go, do you? Keep hold of her.
Nice.
Yeah?
Oh, little wave.
Where's that bucket?
Twice I've eaten the bucket.
Well done.
Oh, well nice done, man. Well done, mate.
Yeah. Well, it'd be nice to get a few different angles.
Yeah.
Put your jacket, Dave.
I don't know what setting. I just fucking ran along.
Looks fine, mate. Pick up, Maddie. Pick up. Pick up. Yeah.
here we go, a bonus going away fish. My memory card on my camera, I had someone videoing me, got full. It was full of blog, so we missed the netting. So I don't know, 20 pound common. Nice little, I'd say, going home bonus. Pack away now. Looks a little bit small compared to what we've just been photographing. But there you go, fish is a fish. I'm happy, you're happy. Dave Salt's the happiest of the lot. And we're off back to Suffolk to do some editing. So, until then.